Come on, if you know you're blessed, go ahead and stand on your feet. Put your hands together. Hey, hey. Folk are selling for stuff you shouldn't be selling for. But when you know something rightly is yours, you say, God, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. I need you to turn that situation around. Turn it around. Slowly but surely. Turn that situation around. Hallelujah, hallelujah. God is worthy of all praise and all glory. And I've been telling y'all, and I'm going to keep telling y'all, there's something about this praise team. I don't know what it is. But see, you got to learn how to work the word. You got to learn how to grab one word and begin to work it. And the word I'm grabbing this morning is simply, I need him to turn it around. That's my word right there. Turn it around. I don't know what your situation might look like. I don't know what it is. But if you got something, you need God to turn around in your life. I dare you to say, Lord, turn it around. Turn my finances around. Turn my children around. Turn my health around. Turn some stuff around in my life. Turn my mind around. Turn my peace around. Turn it around. Weeping may endure for a night, but look at somebody say in the middle of the night, all of a sudden my joy gonna come, cause he gonna turn it around. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Ishaba, if my people, which were called by my name, will humble themselves and pray, turn from their wicked ways. We got to turn first. And when we turn, he begins. Praise the Lord, everybody. God is good and worthy to be praised. I know they say we was having some technical difficulties, but I don't care. I got 4 or 5 folk up in here this morning, and I feel like preaching this morning. So I don't care if you hear, look at somebody say, I'm blessed to be in the house this morning because I need a word. I don't know about you, but I came because I needed a word from the Lord. Oh, God. Say, well, boy, I thought you was preaching, but I still need a word. Hallelujah. I was talking to pastor this morning. He called me. Right when he got out of prayer, I guess he was leaving the church in Conway, Arkansas. And he said as he was driving, he noticed people running, people going about their day, doing everything, walking the dogs, just living. Nobody is going to church anymore. Nobody is trying to put themselves in a situation where they can change some stuff. And I'm not talking about no worldly stuff. I'm talking about some spiritual stuff. What the pandemic has done for a lot of folk has allowed us to see that we are negligent in some areas. You can see it in the physical, but can you see it in the spiritual? And I don't know about you, but I'm glad that I can come to the house of the Lord. Oh, God! Because every once in a while when I walk in,
And I'm going to keep saying my mind ain't right. Been through all kind of hell all week long. Been wrestling with some stuff. Been trying to hold on. But if I could just make it to the house, enter into his gates with thanksgiving, into his courts with praise, be thankful unto him and bless his holy name. For the Lord is good. He's my strong tower. Hey! And the righteous run in and they are safe. Oh God. Hallelujah. I'm going to take my time. I slow it down for a minute. Need a word from the Lord. About halfway through this year, we've been going through some stuff. Am I the only one that's been going through some stuff? See, if you ain't been going through, you got to check yourself and say, wait a minute, maybe I ain't living the way God want me to live. For the Bible says many are the afflictions of the them that live godly shall suffer what? See, the fight comes with us trying to do the will of God. It's easy to just conform to the world. But Paul says, I beg you, brethren, by the mercies, not the mercy, but the mercies of God, to be ye transformed by the renewing of one's mind. Why must we renew our minds? I was talking with Pastor, and I said, I remember reading this scripture, and I got some Bible scholars in here, but I believe it's in Colossians where it says, the sinful nature places our mind against the will of God. And all of us was born in sin and what? Shaped in iniquity. So our mind wrestles with the will of God. Paul breaks it down in the book of Romans chapter 7, latter end. He says, the good that I would, that I do not. And every time I'm trying to do good, I find another law warring against the members of my mind, bringing me into captivity of the law of sin was in my members. Oh, wretched man that I am. Who shall deliver me from the body of this? I feel like preaching this morning because the fight is real. I didn't come in here just because I felt good. I came in here because I need some stuff I need to conquer. Woo! And the more you walk with God, the more you see yourself, the more you look in the mirror, the more you realize I'm getting better, but I'm not what God designed already. I got to press towards the mark of the high calling, which is in Christ Jesus. I wrestle with some stuff. And I ain't talking. The greatest wrestling is not against sin. The greatest wrestle is when God has deposited something in your spirit. Oh, God. And you see this in Gethsemane. When Jesus began to pray, and he's praying, and he said his blood, his sweat began to turn to blood. It was a very deep prayer, Sister Johnny, because he was getting into, have you ever prayed to the point when God has placed something on you and you feel like it's too heavy for you to bear? I'm talking about your praying, saying, Lord, I don't know if I really want to do this. I don't even know if I can love this deep anymore. I don't even know if I can take these steps anymore. But the Bible says the steps of a good man are ordered by God. And every once in a while, I want him to take his orders back because I don't want to go that way. I don't want to feel the pain anymore. I don't want to feel the hurt anymore. I don't want to get down in myself anymore. Because against hope, you got to believe in hope. The war against wrestling against the will of God. I know what he's saying, but I know what I'm feeling. And I can't separate it sometimes. That's when you got to get into a whole other level of prayer. You got to stop standing and praying. You got to get down on your knees and pray. And then there's a time when you go further than that. You lay prostrate before the Lord. And you say, Lord, I'm just going to lay right here until you bless my soul. Evan, you got to hold them keys for just a minute because it's hot in here. And Tamika had me running 6 miles on yesterday, and I don't want to fall out. I don't see none of the health professionals here this morning. But I believe God placed something in my spirit. And I'm still trying. I was talking to Pastor and I said, I'm trying to figure out direction. But when I look at everything that's going on in the world today, we don't have to look too far outside of Little Rock, Arkansas, where there's no value of human life anymore. When we look around, we see so many folk dying. And I was listening to a study, and I think it says over 90% of the murders in Little Rock, Arkansas are black on black crime. And it says in Pine Bluff, Arkansas, 100% of the murders were black on black crime. Lord, we need your help. Because when one person dies, it affects so many. When one person is murdered, it affects so many. We just come out of a pandemic where our black and brown brothers had to struggle more than anybody. Corona was taking us out because we were not in position to attack it. It was something about our health, something about our eating habits, something about our body makeup, something about what the devil had designed in our life. But you got to tell yourself, it's come a time in my life where I got to start to value my life. I tell my children, go to point A and go to point B. That's it. Go where your destination and come on back home. Because folk are crazy right now. When you look up, we see so many of us, mass shootings every day. Folk just don't have any value. Matter of fact, they'll take your life and turn around and take theirs. No value for life. And it don't seem to be getting any better. But it seems to be getting worse. You see young people that still got so much life left to live. 20 and 15 and I mean so many young people been dying. And so many young people been committing murders and crime. I don't understand why we don't value life anymore. There was a time when I would spend time at grandma's house. And even though grandma was kind of small, and I got a little older, grandma would take that hand and pop me upside my head. And I was strong enough to go back at grandmama, but I was wise enough to sit my butt down. Nowadays, if grandmama raised her voice, the kids would slap her back. No value for life. No morals. No integrity. And if you don't have any values, you cannot grow properly. No value for life. I can remember mama. My mama was a fighter when she was younger. So some of that still carried over to old age. And every once in a while, me being a little hard-headed boy, I would say some stuff and mama come and pop me upside my head, grab me by my ear, and I say, mama, you hurt my ear. Never would I snatch back, never would I turn, because I value my mama. I value my life, because I know if I touch mama, daddy said, if you came in this world, I'd bring you in this world, and I'd do what? I'd take you out. And I believe that with all my heart and all my might. I had enough respect for life. If I could use for a scripture text on this morning, I'm already preaching, y'all. The Bible tells us in the book of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, new translation, a new living translation, and it reads thus. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he's planned for us long ago. And I'm going to stop right there. For we are God's masterpiece. For a topic, if you would, Brother Potter, come get this. I'm going to need it. For a topic, if you would, I would like to use, I got to get something for this. I got to get something for this. And I almost just want to jump in, Brother Evan, but I'm going to be obedient. I got to get something for this. Ah, I got to get something for it. I don't even know which way I'm going, Brother Vernon, but I got to get something for this. When we look at it, the value of something is the regard that something is held to deserve, the importance, worth, or usefulness of something. I'm going to say it again. Value is simply the importance, the worth, or the usefulness of something. The value of something. I got to get something for this. Whew. The value of it. And when we look at life, and we look at one way we see a lot of valuable things is in art. We got Leonardo da Vinci. We got, was it Pablo Picasso? We got, what's the one to begin with an M? I can't think of his name, but y'all know what I'm talking about. Huh? Michelangelo. We got some people who have designed some very special pieces of art. When we look at the Mona Lisa is a painting. It's a masterpiece because it is superb, because of its superb piece. Let me say it again. The Mona Lisa is the painting. It's a masterpiece because it's a superb piece of design due to it being realistic. I'm going to say it again. This is a superb piece because it's realistic. When we see the Mona Lisa, ain't nothing really special about her. It's just a woman that's been painted by Picasso. No, by Leonardo da Vinci. And he painted this and it's just real. Oh, God, I hear you, Lord. It says, being realistic, it says, and it is profound. It is a profound assertion of human value because it is about a virtuous woman. And we look at it, and I looked at it, and I'm like, why does the Mona Lisa cost so much? It wasn't nothing beautiful about her to me. Matter of fact, I don't even think the woman got any eyebrows. Hair was straight and just looked like. But when you look at the price of the Mona Lisa, oh my God, my stuff didn't transfer. I think the price of the Mona Lisa, it is around $580 million today. One painting by one man, a masterpiece, around $580 million. But we can go a little step further and we start dealing with Picasso. A Picasso, let me say it like that. Picasso invented a new way of picturing things. Oh my God. Even as he worked in a number of styles, we learned that Picasso showed objects from many viewpoints at a time, distorted shapes and colors to convey emotions, while also simplifying things into basic shapes. A Picasso is said to be worth around anywhere from $500 million to $1.3 billion. It's very expensive. And it says, this is why, because of his unique design, how he took different viewpoints, different distortions, different shapes, different colors to convey emotions. This is why his paintings were so expensive. And he also sculptured things. And that's why they were so expensive, because of how he spoke it and related to life. Oh, God. But everything that Picasso made was not a masterpiece. But I know somebody that everything he made was a masterpiece. I feel like preaching, but hold that organ, Brother Evan. He says, for we are God's masterpiece. A masterpiece depends on three different things. And I'm almost done. A masterpiece depends on three different things. And a masterpiece is very valuable. I got one question for you this morning. Do you consider yourself a masterpiece? Do you know who crafted you? Do you know who made you? Do you know who skillfully brung you together? He was the master of creation. So if he was the master of creation, then you must be a masterpiece. Well, a masterpiece depends on three different things. Number one is the skill of the master. Hey! See, in order to be a master, you got to spend time in school and studying the art and studying the craft and studying whatever you're doing. It talks about the skill of the master. So many people, before they can become a master, they spend a lot of time perfecting their art. Oh, God. The skill and the skill of the master. Skill is simply defined as the ability to do something well. What are you a master at? It says the ability to do something well. It says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God, and all things were made by him, and without him was nothing made. I'm talking about the master of creation. He made everything, but he didn't stop there. When he began to make the world, he spoke some stuff in existence, but then when he came to man, he said, let me make man. Let us make man in our own image, and in our likeness, and in our design. You got to tell yourself, I'm a masterpiece. I was made by the one who has all power in his hands. I'm a masterpiece, and I got to get something for this. I got to get something for what the master created. That's one thing he does. But let me go right here in the book of Colossians, chapter 1, verse 16. It says, for by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in the earth, visible and invisible, whether there be thrones and dominions, principalities and power, all things are created by him and for him. You got to realize I was created for the master. I was created for his pleasure. I was created so he can look at me and see his design. I was made by his hand. I was created by him. I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. I am a masterpiece of all creation. See, everything God made was a masterpiece, but I'm his special masterpiece. You got to say it like you believe it. I am God's masterpiece. Oh, God. Oh, God. And secondly is the master's expression in the artwork. First was the skill of the master. Second is the master's, the master's expression in his artwork. I told you, Picasso, his was that he was able to express many viewpoints at a time. And also, he showed distorted shapes and colors to convey emotions. When you look at this right here, it says it depends on the master expressions in his artwork. Expression is simply defined as the process of making known one's thoughts our feelings. Making known one's thoughts are one's feelings. And when I look at the book of Psalms, chapter 8, verse 3 and 5. Can you give me that in the King James Version? Psalms chapter 8, verse 3. I'm coming back with it in a TPT. If you can't hurry up, I'll get it right soon. It says, when I consider your heavens, the work of their fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have ordained, what is man that you're so mindful of, and the son of man that you visit him? Come on. For you have made him a little lower than the angels, and you have crowned him with glory and honor. I'm talking about the expressions of God when it came to making me. You have made him to have dominion over the works of your hands, and you have put all things under his feet. Keep on going, brother. all sheep and oxen, every beast of the field. Come on. He says, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea that pass through the paths of the sea. Come on. Oh, Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. I'm talking about the expressions of God. When I look at what he has done with me, I'm the very expression. He wrote me out. He designed me. He said, before I formed thee in the belly, I already knew the plans I had for you. You ought to know what God knows about you. And the only way to figure that out is you got to dive in his word. But when I look at it over here in the book of Psalms chapter 8 verse 3 in the Passion Bible, it says, look at the splendor of your skies. You created genius glowing in the heavens. Oh God, you created genius growing in the heavens. When I gaze at the moon and the stars, mounted like jewels in their settings. I know you are fascinating artists. I'm going to say it again. I know you are a fascinated artist who fashioned it all. He says, I know God is a fascinating artist, better than Picasso, better than Michelangelo, better than Leonardo da Vinci. I'm talking about God, a fascinating artist who designed all things. But when he came to me, he made me a little lower than the Elohim. Oh God, I feel like preaching right now. He says, but I look. Get off of there. Oh, I'm messing with this. Oh, there it is. He says, but when I look up and I see the wonders of your workmanship above, I have one question to ask you. Compared to all this cosmic glory, why would you bother with puny mortal man? Or infatuated with Adam's son? Yet, with all honor you have given to men, you have created only a little lower than Elohim, crowned them like kings and queens with glory and magnificence. What he's simply saying right here, I made you a little bit lower than me. I've crowned you like kings and queens. You are my masterpiece. That's what I'm talking about. You are the very expression of what I am. I am Lord of Lords. I am King of Kings. And you are my expression. Oh God. But last but not least, I hear my help coming now. Last but not least, what divine, oh God, what describes something as a masterpiece is the story behind it, Sister Eloise. The story behind the whole painting. And when I look at you and I look at me, everybody got a story. I got a story and you got a story. My story might not be your story, but my story is unique in me. I've been created, oh God, to do good will. But in the process of me writing out my life, in the process of me walking out my life, I should say, that God has created, I've been through some stuff, got some scars, got some pains, got some divorces, got some hurts, got some mistreatment, but I'm still being designed by God, because he said, I foreknew you before I even made you. Look at your story. When I look back over my life and everything I've been through, all the folk I lost, all the deaths I've been through, all the drugs I smoke, all the pain I hurt, all the scars I made. Oh God, it's my story, and can't nobody rewrite your story but you. Oh, oh. Hey, Shabbat. Paul's story went like this. Paul says, I was circumcised when I was 8 days old. I'm pure-blooded citizen of Israel, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. I'm a real Hebrew, if there was anyone. I was a member of the Pharisees who demanded the strictest obedience of the Jewish law. He says, listen, my story. He says, I was shipwrecked. I was put in prison. I was, oh God, I was snake-bitten. I had to ride in on broken pieces. Can you see something in your story? Has it always been perfect? Have you had to go through some stuff? Do you got a story this morning? All the hell I've been through, and you gonna tell me I can't get something for this? I gotta get something for this. I'm a masterpiece of God's creation, and when I go through what I'm going through, it makes me more valuable. It makes me more important. It makes me more. Oh God. I feel like preaching right now. I can't speak for everybody, But when I came in here this morning, I was bowled over with a whole bunch of problems, worrying about this and worrying about that. But when I look back over my life, I don't believe he brought me this far to leave me. He's still walking with me. He's still talking with me. I'm still believing to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I got to get something for this. I refuse to settle. I refuse to quit now. Oh God, don't get weary in well doing, for you will reap if you faint not. Hey Shabbat. That was Paul's story. Oh God. Paul had a story. He had a story, but I know somebody else who had a story. Jacob had a story. Jacob said, wait 1 minute, and I can see myself in Jacob's story, Minister Avery. It was a time in my life when I was getting out, God. I was in the presence of God and I didn't even know it. Have you ever missed the move of God? You missed the move of God and it made you realize, if I ever get back there again, Sister Johnny, if I ever get back there again, Sister Whitley, I ain't gonna miss it. And Jacob said, wait 1 minute. He came back to a place and he was left alone. See, that's the problem with most of us. We're afraid to get alone. But when you get alone with God, when you find yourself in a place, then he can begin to let you know how valuable you really are. Are you valuable today? What's your net worth? A Picasso might be worth 1.3, but I was worth the blood. Oh God, help me right now. So when we look at this right here, you got Jacob. Jacob said, wait 1 minute. I'm going to wrestle. He said, we're left alone. And there came a man to him. And there he was in a struggle. I told you earlier, the greatest fight you're going to have is not against sin, but it's against God. And Jacob was wrestling with God. And in the midst of him wrestling, he said, I'm not going to let you go till you bless me. What he was simply saying, I got to get something for this. I hear you, Lord. I got to get something for this. I don't know about you, but anytime I come in contact with God, I got to get something for it. Give me some more sound on these monitors. When you're alone with God, wrestling late in the midnight hour, weeping may endure for a night, but I'm going to wrestle until my joy come. I'm going to wrestle until my breakthrough come. I'm going to wrestle until the chains fall off. I'm going to wrestle until you change my name. That ain't even me anyway. Jacob realized right then, I might have been living a lie. I've been living as a trickster. I've been living as a fool. I've been living trying to get over. But God says, I've already changed your name. But there's going to be a war going on. Because now I changed your name. But I need to change your mindset. That's where the fight comes. See, you've been looking down on yourself. You ain't even saying you're a masterpiece. You've been talking about I'm messed up from the flow up. I'm toe up. I'm a divorcee. I'm an ex-alcoholic. I'm a sorry piece of... But you, God says, you are my creation. You are everything that I made. And I know the plans I have for you. You are my masterpiece. You have been designed by God. You are very valuable. See, when you look at everything that went through, folks steal stuff. The Bible says the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. We might as well go ahead and have some church. He says, he comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Why would somebody steal something of non-value? He comes to steal your value. And when I look at Eve and Adam in the garden. Eve and Adam was in the garden and the devil came suppliant to them and he stole something from Eve. He stole something from Adam. He stole the very presence of the peace. Have your peace been stolen? And then you see Adam and Eve trying to live out a lie. They were trying to cover themselves and hide from the very one who created them. I ain't got time to be hiding from God. I'm a masterpiece. I got to get something for everything I've been through. I've been through the storm. I've been through the flood. I've been through the fire. I've been through hell. I've been through so much. I got to get something for it. I don't know about you this morning, but when I look at everything
Adam and Eve messed it up. They messed it up so bad that the price was high for us to get it back. See, they call it a ransom. And a ransom is something that you have to pay back to get it back. Oh, God, you have to make a down payment, not a payment, but a payment in full to get something back. See, they wrote, God, you were ransomed out. And they said, wait a minute, money can't pay it. The highest, oh, God, amount of ransom that has ever been paid is about $500 billion. But I know one person who paid a little bit more. His name was Jesus. He paid his blood. And let me tell you right now, what all he paid for me, I got to get something for it. I got to walk out my life. I got to believe to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I got to get something for this. I got to get something. And on the day of Pentecost, oh, I got to get something for this. The Bible tells us that we have this treasure in earthen vessels. It's something that you carry on the inside that is very valuable. It's not on the outside. It's on the day of Pentecost. The very one that created you and made you a masterpiece said, I'm not finished with you. So he said, let me deposit all of me in you. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of ourselves. He goes on to say, we are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not destroyed, always caring about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus Christ, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our bodies. For we who live are always delivered to death for Jesus' sake, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in this mortal flesh. So then the death worketh in us, but life in you. I have this treasure in an earthen vessel, and I got to get something for this. I can't speak for everybody in here right now, but I got to get something for it. It's many days I feel like quitting. Many days I get tired because I don't understand. When you walk in order footsteps, you wish everything would line up with your will. Why do I have to go through what I'm going through? Why does the sickness have to attack my body? Why do I have to lose loved ones? Why does my finance have to be messed up? Why do I struggle what I struggle with? But I have to ask myself and remind myself, I have this treasure in this earthen vessel. He designed us to carry something so precious. And he told Jeremiah, he says, I need you to go down to the potter's house. See, the problem is when you walk into the potter house and you see yourself on the wheel, marred, are broken in the hands of the master. Shouldn't be thinking the way I'm thinking. When I got all power on the inside, Sister Chuck, but I'm on the wheel. And he told Jeremiah, he said, don't you think I can do to you like the master's doing to that pot of clay? Well, he's seen it marred, but he said, I'm going to make it again. Another. Because it's so important to me. Because I need you to carry something. We're living in a time right now where most people are giving up on God. Because they don't understand how valuable they are. When you understand that there was no goodness of your own, but God designed you to carry not just to carry but to make my identity known to all the world. By this will men know that you are the sons of God. That you show love one towards another. Oh, Lord, help me right now. I feel him changing some stuff in me. Give me 5 minutes and I'm done. The last 3 years of my life has been the roughest 3 years of my life. But I thank God, because it was times he left me alone, Sister Wood. He says, I'm going to isolate you. Not for you to be destroyed, but for you to realize that there's some stuff in you I need to transform. I need you to see that you have been trying to create a better way of doing something. When he says, I need you to create a new way. No longer a caterpillar, but a butterfly. I have to put you in a place of isolation and break everything down. I want this stuff fixed real quickly. I wanted my kids to be fixed real quickly. I wanted my marriage to be fixed real quickly. I wanted me to be fixed real quickly. But in the process, God says, I'm taking you through a transformation. And every transformation don't feel good, but it is good. Hey! And when I look back, I see I lost some loved ones. Lost some family members. Some of us lost some mamas. Some of us lost some fathers. Some of us lost some spouses. But God says, I'm still here. And if I'm still here and you're still here, I'm still working on you because you're valuable to me. And he says, everything you've been through is going to work for my good. Just don't give up in the process. Hey. Keep on pressing towards the prize of the high calling, which is in Christ Jesus. Woo! I got to get something for this. Not for all the hell I've been through, but for all the hell he's been through. I hear you, Lord. I hear you. I ain't gonna lie, when I was preaching this, I'm thinking about all the hell I've been through. But all of a sudden, he dropped in my spirit. And he said, all the hell I went through was for you to become my masterpiece. And how dare you not get something for all the hell I've been through for you. I created you, oh God, in my image. And then I died so you could become everything. And I got to get something. I got to get something for every bit of, for every whip, for every stone, for every nail, for every drop of blood. I got to get something. Too close now, Sister Will. Too close now, Sister Whitley. My story might not be your story, but we all connected by one story. Whoa! And that story is that he died for each and every one of us individually. And I came by here this morning to let you know, you got to get something. For every drop of blood he shed for you, you got to get something. For every time they whipped him, he was bruised for my iniquities. The chastisement of my peace was upon him, but with every stripe, I get something for it. Come on, Brother Vernon. You might be out there in Facebook land right now. Go ahead and lift up your hands right now and say, Lord, I got to get something for every drop of blood, every pain, every scar. You're writing my story. Hey!
I'm going to see you. I'm going to see it. I'm going to see it. Gonna see my victory. I'm gonna see it. I'm gonna see it. I'm gonna see it. See it. See it. Gonna see my victory. I'm gonna get it. I've got to get it. I'm going to get it. I'm going to get it. Gonna get my victory. Reach up and get it. 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 You're gonna get your victory.
Greetings in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ. My name is Frank Stewart. I'm the pastor of Acts Ministries in Conway and also in North Little Rock. We also have an outreach on John Barrow where we partnership with the city and other ministries there. I want to invite you to partner with us in this ministry. I want to invite you to share with us in propagating the gospel of Jesus Christ. There are many things that we're doing and we're going to continue to do. We have a vision in mind on how to be a blessing to the communities that we're in. So we're asking you to be a partner with us. I believe that God will reward you and he will multiply you. So join us in the Acts Ministry in sponsoring not only this broadcast, but what we're doing in the great city of Little Rock, North Little Rock, and also Conway. God bless you. I need you.
You need me.
We need one another.
And how we need God. During these uncertain times, there's one thing that all of us can do to protect one another, and that is to wear a mask.
Whatever you do, wherever you go, whenever you're around anyone, please wear a mask. I am Pastor Frank Stewart.
And I'm Lady Jacqueline Stewart.
And on behalf of Acts Ministries, we love you and we need you to survive.
So,
mask up.
The Acts Ministries is located at 1423 Ingram in Conway and 1224 Franklin Street in North Little Rock. Call 501-329-2055 or go to acksministriesonline.org for more information. We would love you to partner with our ministries. Please go to our website, acksministriesonline.org, and find out how you can partner with us. For your gifts, please click on the Donate Online button or text the amount you wish to give to 501-302-4242.